Hi, Fernando. I'm Sarah from The Upcoming. An absolute pleasure to be able to speak to you today. How are you? Okay.
I'm doing great. Great to meet you.
Great to meet you. And thank you so much for this incredible documentary. I have to admit up front, I'm very much a fan of snowboarding. Been doing it since I was younger. So I found, had a special interest in the film. But my first question would be, what was your way into this? Because in some respects, it's kind of a love letter to the sport, a history of the sport, but it's also a tribute to this incredible man and this incredible entrepreneur, Jake Burton Carpenter. So what was your starting point and why were you so motivated to make this documentary about it?
Well, I didn't know. I'm not a snowboarder like yourself. So I came to it totally like an alien, what's all this stuff, right? People are talking about. And I really didn't know who Jake was. So when I heard about the project, I started, exploring who this man was. And Ben Bryan from Red Bull Media House, who I'd made another film with, he told me about the project. And he's like, we're doing this project. It's a ton of directors going out for it. But I just wanted to know if you might be interested in it. So I said yes. And I started, I think what I really focused on was the Miller Fisher aspect of his journey, because it was 3 years ago, so it was near that time, and so I was just blown away by the resiliency and the strength of this man. So I made a 7-minute short, which I showed Jake, and it kind of primarily revolved around that. There's very little snowboarding in it. It was his kind of journey through Miller Fisher, and when I met him, I showed it to him, and he was very moved, and he was emotional, and he was crying, and but I didn't get the job. Somebody else got the job at that point. Like a year later, that team started to, that whole, for whatever reason, some kind of legal reasons, this didn't work out. And that was around the same time that Jake got sick. Mm-hmm. And then Jake passed away at the end of 19. And then when the family was, they were gonna move ahead with the project. And so Ben was asking them, so do you wanna open up the process again, the interview process? And Donna and Timmy and the kids said, well, Jake really loved Fern, He always wanted Fern to be a part of the project in some way. So why doesn't he direct it? Like, let's give it to him, right? And so it was very bittersweet, very bittersweet. But I think my in into the story was very much what you talked about, is this entrepreneur, this guy who saw something that wasn't there and he made it a reality. And it really is the history of snowboarding told through his eyes, told through his experience, Tom Sims and the West Coast pioneers, they have a different history of snowboarding. Mm-hmm. And then it does interconnect with Jake at some point and Burton, but it's different. But this is Jake's story and the history of snowboarding and his story in a lot of ways, is the history of snowboarding, because he was there from the beginning. But it's very much his point of view.
And it's almost incredible, because I think I didn't really know much about kind of the history of the sport. And it's quite amazing actually to read, that headline that was, world's worst new sport or whatever it was. They weren't allowed on the hills, the centers wouldn't allow them to go on the lifts. And there really was this kind of, it was this outsider, not quite a cult, but it had its their followers, but they weren't kind of accepted in the mainstream. So what was it like going back and kind of, it must have been an education for you, but and to be able to pass that on to viewers as well, provide that stuff that maybe people don't even really realize?
No, fascinating. I mean, I have crusty snowboarders, like 60-70-year-old snowboarders, come to me like, I thought I knew everything, I didn't know that. I don't know that part of it. And that's really cool. We just did like a total deep dive. And Jake left. He was very involved in the development of the film before he passed. So he left a detailed chronology. He left all the breadcrumbs. We followed them all. And, we we didn't stop. You know, we felt like an obligation to get it right. And I think because Jake wasn't here, and because the more I learned about him, the more I realized how important he was as a person to so many people, as a leader, as a friend, as a father, all of these things, and how influential he was. So we wanted to get all the details right. And we went like, you know, and we searched everywhere, and we got some amazing footage, some amazing archive. But it was the details. It was the specificity of his story that I think connects with people, you know.
And what was that process like then? Because you do have this incredible kind of montage running through, you know, it's kind of spliced in with the interviews of, you know, the kind of beauty shots of people coming down the mountain. But then it's everything else that's going on kind of at the sidelines of the competitions and the parties. So, you know, where did you even begin to find all that? And how do you decide what to include to kind of build your narrative?
Right. Well, we knew where we were going to go, right, with the story. And the story is, well, if you know where you're going to go, then you have a better idea how you're going to get there, and you can plot your course, right? And we kind of landed on Jake's final moment, his final words, pretty early in the process when he says, you know, I'm not a spiritual guy, but I learned about, you know, I learned about love and family and pain, and I learned not, you know, to live life to the fullest. That's not why he started a snowboarding company for love, life, and pain, and to live to the fullest. That's, he wanted to make money. He wanted to get rich, right? And quick. That was the intention. And it became something completely different. It became this thing that, this gift he gave to humanity of like joy, you know, and creative expression and freedom and creativity. And so once we knew that that's where we were going, you know, we had a very detailed outline, you know, but I mean, we got everything. So we just asked and begged for footage from everybody, but we stuck to our outline and we stuck to the chronology of the story we were going to tell. And so there were really interesting things too in the archive that just didn't fit our story. Mm. You know what I mean? I mean, you can really, the history of snowboarding could be a 10-part Netflix series. There's so much stuff, right? There's so much stuff, and I think somebody should make it because it's fascinating. But again, this was this was Jake's version of the history. So we focused around his arc, the arc of his life, and inside of that arc, you have the history of snowboarding and the history of Burton, and all the mistakes that he made, all of the errors, all of the miscalculations. I mean, Burton was all in on alpine skiing and alpine racing. That's where they thought the sport was in the early 80s. You know, they're like, you know, like super cold, icy Vermont. Snowboarding is like racing. And then they go to the West Coast and they're like, what the fuck is this? How do you even judge this? You know, and they were definitely trying to catch up for a lot of it. But they did catch up, and that was Jake's genius. Like, he would he was quick to see his errors and his faults, and not just that, he was always trying to get better. And you know, after Craig Kelly became part of Burton, his whole focus was listening to the riders, right? And every decision he made, I think from then on out, was to make the experience of riding snowboard more pleasurable. Mm-hmm.
And I think that's something that's great about the documentary, because of course, maybe there's a temptation, particularly when, you know, there's an element of it that's kind of a tribute to this person, you know, maybe for it all to be a bit kind of, you know, through rose-tinted glasses, but you don't shy away from the mistakes he made and the kind of side of it. You know, it was a business that has grown to be, I think it's $700 million valued company. So, you know, was it important to you to kind of provide that bit of balance and sort of, you know, include sort of the downsides and the low moments as well as the highs and the amazing bits?
Sure. Important for me, important for the family, and important for Jake. You know, like I said, he left the outline, and he wanted the whole story, you know, and the family was very supportive and hands off as far as content. Their only concern was that we were accurate and factually accurate, right? Factually right. But they didn't, they never told us to like, don't go there. But it was a little weird in the sense that Jake had just passed away, right? And in the interviews, you know, the people loved this man, they really did. And I'm like, so let's talk about the patent. And everybody was like, yeah. You know, but luckily for us, Jake talked about it. And Jake was honest about it. And he was like, biggest fuck up of my life, you know? And then we were able to get, you know, like Todd Bridges, Pat Bridges, sorry. Pat Bridges, the editor of Snowboarding Magazine, he's fantastic. He just keeps it honest, you know? And like, and he's right down the middle. Like he's like this crazy snowboarding historian. So it was great to have him and the few voices that we could find, like Tom Burt, Bob Klein, who were from the Tahoe area, who like, yeah, you know, really put a scare into small businesses and to just to give that balance, you know, I mean, every film needs that balance or else it's just going to be dismissed as fluff, as a tribute piece. And it was never meant to be a tribute film. You know, the film was conceived when Jake was alive. Mm-hmm. You had to, you know, quickly find a new direction after he passed away, and then find a different one, you know, once COVID hit. Mm.
And, you know, how did you kind of go about getting all these amazing interviews and particularly having Woody Harrelson, you know, mm-hmm. kind of narrating those Dear Rider letters that were in front of the catalogs? And it must have become something else as well, like you say, after he passed away, that those interviews kind of took on a different tone and meaning, particularly with his wife.
Yeah, I mean, we shot a lot of the interviews in February at the Vail US Open, right? A lot of the ones with the writers, but we knew we couldn't interview the family yet because it had only been a couple of months since Jake passed away, right? So, and that was all good, you know, because we were going to travel, we were going to go to Chile, we were going to go to Austria, we were going to go to so many places, right? Vermont. Anyways, we never left our home offices, you know, from that point on, right? So everything was remote. You know, we learned how to, like a lot of people did during the last 2 years, learn how to work remotely. We shot those interviews remotely. We did all the scouting, you know, like through an iPhone, and I'm like, yeah, let's shoot Donna here, right? But there was a lot of trust building, you know, like Donna and I and the kids, and their sons, we talked a lot before, and we shared footage and cuts with them before. So by the time that we sat down with them, there was a sense of trust, right? But yeah, we shot it remotely in Vermont, the family, I think in the middle of the summer, and the Tahoe interviews were shot remotely. And yeah, we just figured it out. But I don't think you can tell, like looking at the film that you know, I was like 3,000 miles away in the interview, you know, but they were looking at my face, you know, and on the laptop, but in reality, they're looking right at the camera. I don't know how they did it, but the lighting was great. And the DPs that we had to use around the country were fantastic. Mm.
And then just finally, you know, what do you hope people will take away from watching it? Because I have to say, it's kind of educational in one respect. It's, you know, capture some of that evangelical nature of like, you know, the snowboarding community. It sort of makes you want to get out there on the mountain. Mm. But it's also got a lot of themes in there about family, about finding meaning in life, about mm-hmm. resilience. So, you know, there's so many different parts to it. What do you hope people take
away? So many different parts. And that's what I love about it. There's a lot of themes, a lot of layers. There's a lot of there's a lot of subtext to this film that maybe there wouldn't be in a regular sports documentary. Mm. Right. Because in a lot of ways, you know, that's what attracted me. It's not the snowboarding. I think snowboarding is fantastic. And I've met, Like all of a sudden I went from like, what's snowboarding to like, hey Mark, what's up? You know, Marvin Morris and Kelly Clark. And I'm on first name basis with these amazing snowboarders, right? And they're all the best, most humble, nicest people. So I have an appreciation for the sport now and for the people that practice the sport. And I understand the love and the passion for it. But I think it's this idea of, you know, this have as much fun as possible. I kind of get that. Weirdly, when I met Jake, when I was leaving the room, I felt like I hadn't really nailed it. And clearly I didn't, because I didn't get the job. But I felt like, oh my God. So as I was leaving the room, I turned to him and I was like, you know, we would have a lot of fun together making this. And he looked at me like, kind of like, I remember he looked at me, gave me this strange look, and I interpreted in the moment as like, I was like, really? Like, that's your pitch? We're gonna have a lot of fun? And I was like, that's just what came out. And then I at that moment I felt like I wanted to bring it, like I wanted to take it back. But when I got the job, and then I learned about have as much fun as possible, and I realized that that's something that he really believed in. I was like, yeah, you know, and I get that. And because of all of those things you mentioned, because life is short, because of family, because you don't know when your last day is going to come up, and so this idea of have as much fun as possible really is important, and to live life passionately. But to live life passionately, you have to find your passion, right? Mm-hmm. You can't live your life passionately if you don't like your life, if you don't like what you're doing, right? So find what it is what you're doing and then do it passionately. So it's not a lesson about snowboarding in the sense, it's more about like, find your passion in life and then live that passion and then live it passionately. And I think that to me is great, because I've had people that have seen the film that don't snowboard and they're like, yeah, you know, I got to get back to rock climbing, or I got to get back to writing books. I got to get back to like, whatever it may be, I got to get back to teaching yoga, you know, because I'm passionate about that. And that just, I don't know, blah, 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 pandemic or whatever. And I just got to get back to it. But it's that passion that fuels us and that fills us up. And I think that's a great thing. But like you said, there's a lot of subtext, there's a lot of themes, and different people have come up to me and have told me like, you know, all kinds of things from like, I got to get back. I love snowboarding and I love learning the history to like, I got to get out there and really think about what I want to do with my life. You know, like all those things. And those are great things, you know, and I think Jake was a perfect role model for that. And again, his intentions were very much rooted in that American entrepreneurial spirit of making something and getting rich, right? But it became something much more meaningful. But he had to like hit rock bottom for him to find the meaning, you know, and he had to suffer loneliness, and he had to endure that loneliness. And that loneliness is something that you know, he endured as a child, you know, as a teenager, losing his brother, his mom, and then he was very much left alone because his sisters were too far apart in age. And then, you know, following this passion led him to even more loneliness, right? Mm-hmm. And then he swore, he didn't tell me, but I bet he never wanted to be lonely again, you know? And I think family and community, the family and community that he needed to survive and that he wanted and that he needed, he infused the DNA of snowboarding with that, I believe, because so much of snowboarding is community and family, you know, and like, there is no other sport like snowboarding. Like, I don't see skiers like feeling like a community, you know. I mean, it's a great sport and it's, I'm not hating on skiing, but there's a sense of community to snowboarding that I think is, is just different, and it's particular to that to that sport. And then when somebody becomes a snowboarder, it's almost like they join the family, right? And they join this community. And Burton, you know, and the Carpenters are such lovely people. And Donna is one of the greatest people I've ever met. She's so kind, she's so smart, and she's so generous, right? And all the kids have that in them. And it's been, that's one of the best parts of working on this film, is getting to know them. But then that spirit is imbued in Burton as a company. They feel like a family. And then the snowboarders, and then it's like they all kind of feel that way to me. And maybe it's because I want it to feel that way, because that's what I believe, but that's what it feels like, you know. And I was just in Lax a couple weeks ago, and yeah, it's just like this, it's almost like they're in on a secret. Like, yeah, snowboarding, this is the thing. This is how you have the most fun. And it's really cool to see. And it's great to learn about. And you know, that's one of the great things about being a filmmaker is, you know, the discovery and the deep dive into this world that you don't know anything about. I'd rather make a movie about something I don't know anything about than something I do know about, because I don't come in with prejudices and agendas. You know, I just come in with like curiosity. So
Well, I think I'm over my time, but thank you so much for sharing all that with us. Can you quickly tell us what subjects you're tackling for your next film?
I'm right in the middle of a series for HBO about the life of the Mexican American boxer Oscar De La Hoya.
Amazing.
Yeah. So it's like the Mexican again. If you know, like Jake's film, Dear Writer, is a history of snowboarding told through Jake Burton's eyes. This film is the Mexican experience told through the life of Oscar De La Hoya. So you know, hopefully it lives up to Dear Writer, but yeah, so far so good.
Amazing. Well, thank you so much for sharing all that with us, and I can't wait for everyone else to be able to watch this film, Dear Writer.